Hello there, people. This is Milad Rasaymanesh, Central Committee of Ex-Muslim in Scandinavia spokesperson. Today I have a very special guest here next to me, Shaparak Shajarizadeh, the well-known women's rights activist, has accepted to have a short interview with me. First of all, thank you, Shaparak, for being here. My first question would be, I know you had a speech in Geneva about the like women's situation, the women movement in Iran. Can you please tell us what's happened over there? What was your like main topic, main point that you like highlighted during your speech?
Thank you for inviting me, Milad. Part of my speech is about the repression on Iranian women after the revolution, and the regime's systematic violence towards women. And part of it was in general the violation of human rights. Specifically during inside courtrooms, trials, and in jails. I had a little bit experience. I was both times for a few days in prison, and I've been to some trials, but the main issue for me is if they arrest an activist or a protester or anyone who wants to challenge the government, there is no those people don't have an access to a representative, to a lawyer, and there's not gonna be a fair trial, and they're just the authorities accused all the people with political crimes, and they're not gonna have a fair trial.
Yeah, like most of the people know you as an activist who protested against compulsory hijab in Iran. Why you think it's important to fight against like compulsory hijab in Iran and generally speaking in the whole Middle East?
In my opinion, hijab is a symbol of sexism and sexual discrimination. But in Iran, because it's by the law, compulsory hijab is a law in Iran and is a tool in the hand of government to repress women and to be violent against women. And you know, anybody can be violent. The women don't have any help from anybody when they attack, and it's not just the veil, it's the government's violence against women and sexual minorities.
Talking about the Iranian people, like having like a compulsory hijab and like women's issue like somehow comes on the second or like third priority for like a European, like a Western country policies. They always somehow justify the hijab. For example, in Sweden, we know the foreign minister, Anna Lind, she wore some hijab and like went, traveled to Iran to sign some contract with the President Rouhani and actually ignored like all the fights like a that time were taking place on the street in Tehran, Shiraz, Mashhad, like all around the country. People like you, the things that you're doing outside the country in Europe and like in North America countries, how can you like, you know, change the policy, change the view of the like European politicians regarding the women's issues, hijab, compulsory hijab, and these sort of discourses?
In the conference, I asked them simply. Every time the female politicians they talk about women's rights, and every time something happens to a Muslim community, they feel they are sympathetic and they feel they stand in solidarity with Muslim women, which is great and respectful. But I don't think it's the second or third issue for them. They haven't been paid any attention to the millions of women around the world who are forced to wear hijab and cover their body, and they face violence every day because of compulsory hijab, and specifically in Iran, when they are women's rights activists, brutally kept in a prison, when one of the famous human rights defender is right now in prison and facing decades of.
They always say, like, these politicians that we like, you know, when we talk to these people, they say, like, it's something cultural.
No, this
it's
is
like
not.
Like Javad Zarif, for example, like, had a speech, I think it was in Canada, he was like, the hijab is a dress code. It's like you cannot go to McDonald's, for example, naked. Hijab is a dress code and it's something cultural. What would be your answer?
First of all, it's not our culture. And the second thing, do in Western country, do they dress like people in old centuries? No, people are changing around the world, and Sarif is a liar. Of course, he would say that. But what I'm saying is that. Women's rights activists, they're lawyers, they are inside jail, and at the same time you're coming to Iran, obey compulsory hijab and say it's like a dress code. No, I guess it's hypocrisy.
True. Like, no, we're getting close, let's just go back to Iran again. We're getting close to the 8th of March 2020, the International Women's Day. How you see the Iranian movement at the moment? How you see how strong the Iranian movement are at the moment?
At the moment, the most of the women's rights activists are are silent. They are in jail or other abroad. But now the women, the ordinary women, are the women rights activists inside. Because when I go back to, for example, 2 years ago, I was active, but at the same time, if morality police officer would come to me, and I would scare of him. But right now, if you see the images, those police go and say to tell a girl or woman, put on your hijab, and they are brave enough to tell them in their face, we're not gonna wear hijab and you can do whatever you want with me. Those are the ordinary women who are brave enough to challenge this law. But 8th of March in all the countries around the world, even in suppressive countries, dictatorship systems around the world. On this day, women have rallies and they express themselves in the streets. But Iran is one of the countries that women can't even small groups, they arrest all the women. And it's been 40 years after 8th of March of 1979. Women try to have to do something on this day, to have some rallies, but each time the government suppress those rallies and the women who wanted to express their feelings.
Yeah, I think we have all seen those wonderful footages of women, brave women, fighting against a mullah and akhunds, or the Sharia police on the street. My next question actually would be, how you see the relation between political Islam, Islamism, and women's rights? If I would like to paraphrase the question, would be, can we possibly imagine a society based on equality and humanity as long as political Islam and Islamism is in power? We always hear these discourses saying we can protect the Islamic Republic of Iran, and this other side, we can't guarantee the women's rights. Can we do that really? Do you think that as long as political Islam is in power, we can reach a society based on humanity and equality?
I guess as long as we mix any religion with politics, we're not gonna have freedom. But maybe we can have in future, we can have Islam a religion who's gonna be easier on women. But when it's a political, I don't think so. That's not going to happen, especially in Iran, because I don't think the Islamic regime of Iran is like have these laws based on Islam. They're having these laws to suppress half of the society. That's not going to happen. As long as they are in position and they have the power, they're not going to change. We had hopes people hope that there would be some reform, and one of them was like women's rights. But right now we all know there's not going to be reform in Iran in any way. It didn't happen, and it never happened. Even Shirin Ebadi, the Nobel Peace Prize, mm-hmm. Laureate, she said there's not going to be reform in Iran as long as they...
She used to be like a big reformist, but
she says there's not going to be...
Now.
Yeah, there is not going to be any reform as long as they... they are willing to suppress the people who challenge the government. We're not gonna have reforms in any way, specifically women's rights.
Yeah, let's go back to like a European countries, like a Western societies. One of the big topics always, like, you know, we hear from the like political parties regarding hijab, women's issues, like hijab for children. I know that you like, you know, you're fighting against compulsory hijab in Iran. Sorry, and like, you know, compulsory hijab maybe in Europe and like in Western countries. What do you think? What's your position regarding the hijab for children in Western societies?
I totally agree with banning hijab for kids, the women under age. If a grown up woman, an adult, wants to have hijab, for me, it's like having a kind of dress, like hat or anything. If it's her choice, I respect that. But not for kids. When they are old enough, they can decide for themselves.
One last question. We're getting close to the March 2020, as I mentioned before. How you see, like, you know, the March, the 8th of March opportunity can be used by the Iranian women or like people in Middle East to overcome Islamism, the fraud Islamic government that we have in like most of the countries? How can we use this chance to reach our goals?
Like women activists, human rights activists can use this day to address politicians, to listen and see what's going on inside Iran. The other women, we can have rallies and express ourselves, and again, take these politicians to account and want them to, instead of negotiating with the repressive regime, support the people of Iran. And inside Iran, although that there's nothing on 8th of March last year, 2 years ago, again, there were some women wanted to have a rally. They arrested all the journalists and all the activists. And again, last year, you see, now those brave women are in jail right now, facing years of prison sentences. Yasaman sang those beautiful song, which is a woman's anthem in Iran,
yeah.
With Mojgan and Morire, they were out handing flowers to women with hijab or without hijab, and tell them to be united and stand in solidarity with the protesters, the women who protest compulsory hijab. But what happened? They gave them long sentences, not only they arrested them, they arrested Sabah and her mother too. So I guess this time we're gonna have another thing in Iran. Women in Iran, even inside Iran, they're not silent, and they're not alone. We will do anything to be their voice.
Shaparak Shajarizadeh, thank you very much for being here.
Thank you.